shot's way better.
That was a little bit faster.
Yeah.
That brown bear.
So let's talk about the Mac 10 for a second. I've owned this machine gun. This is a registered machine gun, 1973 45 Mac 10, a real Ingram.
I'll show you the markings here.
She's a real deal, made in 1973. You can see there. I love this thing, and there are some very specific reasons why I love it. I also have a lot of lessons learned with it that I'm going to go over for somebody who is maybe thinking about getting one, or you know, just machine gun stuff in general. This is not how I bought this gun, so you know, I have some shooting video I have on my phone. I haven't really done anything with a GoPro, but I'll put in some shooting video maybe before this and after this. But just off the top of my head, we're going to talk about owning a Mac 10. Owning this specific Mac 10 and the Lage uppers. I actually have two of them. I did a video earlier. This is the 45, and then this is the actual 9mm upper. And I have a original Mac 10 upper as well. This one actually has some MP5 sights welded onto it, so you get a nice MP5 sight picture there. It has a threaded barrel. It came with one of those goofy looking barrel shrouds on it. And this thing fires fast. I'll see if I can dig up some video of how fast this thing fires. I did fire it once with this 9mm upper. It came with this on it. So it looked like this when I bought it. It did have the stock tube, but it had one of those like 80s looking carbine stocks. And I put this CTR stock on it so that I could run a sling mount.
And if you'll notice here, I have a sling mount here, and I have a sling mount on the back, so I can sling this guy up like a rifle, and it's awesome. So, for starters, let's talk about buying this gun. I bought this gun from Rock Island, and I normally don't really like to talk about price and everything, but I got it pretty cheap. So I actually bid on this thing in April of 19, and I got notified in September of 2019 that I won the auction. I just put a low bid. I mean, a stupid low bid. There were four Mac 10s, and they all sold for over $6,000, and this one sold for way less than that. Way less than $6,000, which is pretty cheap, considering what they sell for nowadays. I don't know why this particular gun sold for that cheap. Let's just say the bid was low enough. I was like, well, if I get it, I get a good deal. And if I don't get it, then you know, I don't have to spend any money. But I got notified I won it in an auction with five Mac 10s. This one sold for less than $6,000. And I would call $6,500 a good market price for a Mac 10 in 2020. The paperwork for this was approved in March of 2020. The bad news about being approved in March of 2020, so it took about 6 months, 5 months actually. I went to my gun store and I said, I actually wanted to know if it had, I wanted to see if the magazine adapter fit. So if you look in here, there's an adapter for this magwell to reduce it down to the 9mm caliber, so you can fit the 9mm in there. So the nice thing about this being a 45 is it can shoot 45 or 9mm. That's what the topic of this video is. But I wanted to know if the magwell would fit, and I had bought some mags for it, and I wanted to know if they fit. So I drove to my dealer and I said, hey, can you go get my Mac 10 while I'm waiting on it? I want to see if the mags fit in there. And when he opened the box up, the approved Form 4 was in the box. So my shop actually got the thing in around March of 2020, but they were so busy with pandemic stuff that they never called me. You know, so it had been approved for, I think, a week or two, maybe. And the only reason I even knew about it is because I asked to look at it. So I think that's interesting. The other thing that's interesting is this has never been on a Form 4. So technically, I'm the first owner of this gun. It was on a Form 3 its whole life, from 1973 until now. It's been on Form 3s. And so my dealer seems to think that it was like a machine gun rental gun. It was never actually owned by a person. So I am the first Form 4 transfer for this firearm. And there might be some people in the know who know that, and that's why they didn't bid as high on it as some of the other ones. I don't know. MAC-10s don't have a lot of value. I would actually call $6,500 a market price. If you look online, people are asking more than $6,000. They're asking like $8,000 or $9,000. They're not selling for $8,000 or $9,000 as of December 2020. But when the bids are lower, like when the bid is $5,000, people buy them. So they are selling for that much. And I paid less than that for this. So I'm very happy with that. Now, by the time you add in the cost of these two Lage uppers, it does get to more expensive because the Lage upper is $1,000. Plus all the accoutrement I have on it, like you have to pay for the rails and the grips. And I bought this grip and I bought a mag catch, and we're going to talk about all that stuff. So as soon as I know I won the auction in September, I got on Lage's waiting list. And you saw my video of the one that I got. Well, when he called me about the 45 Mark II upper, the 9mm, he called me the next week. So I got both of these uppers within a week of each other. So I've basically been running this thing full tilt. I do have some video footage of me shooting at 45, but that's only because my friend had some 45. I have never put 45 through this besides those initial mags. 90% of my shooting has been a 9mm. And in 10 months, I have put roughly, let's call it 700 rounds through this gun. And because that's all I had. I did a 500 rounds of Brown Bear all through this gun, and it ran great on Brown Bear. I did four or five mags of 45, and I've probably put maybe 200 or 300 rounds of Winchester White Box plus some various other loadings. So anyway, that's the backstory of this thing. How I got it. I got really lucky because for 2020, 2019, that was a good deal. I got a good deal on this. And I got a lot of money in it by the time you add all these accessories in. But these accessories are what make this gun. And we're going to talk about that. Now, for 45, one of the things that I bought initially, because the goal of this is I can run this. I have a sling mount. I can sling it up. This thing's heavy. This thing probably weighs 12 pounds, maybe 12 pounds easy because it's all in the bolt. I have an optic. My 45 did have an optic. I have a grip. The grip is important because if you don't have the grip, people will put your hand in front of the muzzle and shoot your hand off. So it's important to have a grip. It has a charging handle on the side. This one has a three lug mount that will take my Recoord Huntertown 9mm can. I actually had I'll annotate what Armorer did this. I can't think of their name off the Curtis Tactical. Curtis Tactical in Ohio recored this Huntertown because that's what they do. They record Huntertowns. And I had him thread the back of it for a Silencer Co. mount. So I screwed in a Silencer Co. 3 lug, and now there's a 3 lug. So that's awesome. Super cool. It's not a super good can, but with the recoil, I run it on all my 9mm carbines and it does great. No complaints. You know, I got $600 in a $200 can, but you know, runs good. I'm gonna do a separate video with the recoil. Anyway, so this I ordered the mag catch here. Let's not talk about that first. That's important. Let's talk about this. It came with, let's go from butt to tip. It came with the carbine stock already mounted on it. I assume if I push this button, this will come out. Yep. I've never actually taken this out before. But anyway, see, it comes out like that. And what's nice about this, this is the best. This thing is low enough that when you cheek mount it, your eye perfectly lines up with that optic. So there's enough drop in this stock that it perfectly lines up with whatever sights I have on there. So it's beautiful. The stock makes this gun. This gun is heavy, and the stock and the foregrip allow you to hold it, especially if you sling it up. So that was good. I did not have to pay for that. It came with that. And then I bought this grip here. The grip does two things. It keeps the trigger guard from biting your fingers, as well as adding this little kick down to so that you can mag release. There's no ammo in this. So that you can mag release with your finger here like you would on a modern rifle. Now, shooting at the range, I'll grip it like this. It's pretty much just as easy to grab it like this as it is to drop it like this. Because sometimes the mags don't fall out, especially with the adapter. Without the adapter, the 45s will drop free, but I've had to do some work on this mag adapter, which is the point of this video, to get the 9mm mags to work. So that's the other upgrade I did, plus the lay jumpers themselves. As far as my lessons learned running one of these Mac 10s, it's expensive. It goes through ammo fast. You have to buy ammo in at least a case of 500 to get some shooting out of it. I usually load the mags to 20. I believe the grease gun mags take 25, I think. If you look at how big, another thing that's interesting, look how much bigger that grease gun mag is than that 9mm. That's a big difference.
This is nice because, like,
this serves the purpose of an MP5. Now, it's bigger and it's cruder, more crude, since it's only an open bolt. But really, it being able to shoot 9mm and 45 out of this thing, I don't really have to have another gun. Like, if I got a good deal on, like, a Sten gun or a Riesling or something like that, there's no point in me buying one because this will do everything I need. I can run optics, I can run a can, I can sling it up like a stock, I can do a sub-gun match. You know, I wouldn't necessarily use this for home defense, but you could sling it up and run it like a gun, and I have. It runs just fine with this setup. It runs like a really heavy kind of AR-15, you know? It really, these uppers and these additions, like the sling mount's the biggest thing. This gun is heavy to hold. If you're holding it for a long time, it just wears on you. So to being able to sling this up and, you know, just drop the bolt on a mag and leave it slung up, it's awesome. Totally worth it. Foregrip makes a big difference too because you're not just holding it like this. But anyway, I think the biggest boon of this, besides the lage parts, is the ability for me to run both calibers in it. I bought this right when the pandemic came out. My approval paperwork came back basically March 22nd, March 23rd. My first picture I took of this is in March 23rd, and all the ammo disappeared. So this thing has been 100% reliable with 45. And so let's talk about that now. And it's been better with 9mm than it was when I bought it. It would not run 9mm when I bought it. The one thing about this is Lage sells these mag catches here on the bottom, and it goes just like this, and it has two notches. There's a high notch and this low notch. We got a pointer here. There's a high notch, and then the low notch is right here. And this allows you to run both magazines. Now, if you don't know, most people know, grease guns, or these Mac 10s were set up to run on grease gun mags. Grease guns were really cheap in the 70s. These things were like 50 cents a piece because they were all World War II surplus. And this is a real Mac 10 Military Armament Corporation magazine. This actual magazine is probably worth $100. And I got a handful of them. But if you'll notice here, it's the same as a grease gun mag. This is an unmodified grease gun mag. This one is actually blued, so it's an older gun. I think the World War II vintage, well, they're all World War II vintage. Some of them are blued and some of them are Parkerized. But anyway, if you'll notice, let's line these base plates up. This guy has been slightly cut here, and this one is uncut. So they actually cut this up a little bit so that it so that the Mac 10 would not use standard grease gun mags, and you had to buy the proprietary magazines. So this mag catch basically allows you to run both. You can run this on a Mac 10 mag, or you can run this on the grease gun mag. So you can run both modified and unmodified mags in the stock gun. Now, and this gun has been 100% reliable with grease gun mags. For the couple hundred rounds of 45 I've put through it, it ran no problem. 9mm is the other thing. This is a 9mm upper. And I shot it once. This is the one that shoots like 1200 rounds a minute. It ran good. I think I put one or two mags through it. You know, my brother was being weird at the time, so I couldn't shoot it out where he lives because of the whole pandemic, so I had to keep my distance, and we just wanted to see if it worked. And I had just spent a ton of money on this thing, and I wanted to shoot it. So this thing worked good, but, you know, I got my lage upper within a week, and it wouldn't run anything. I didn't have any mags for it. So I bought these. These are FTF mags. FTF Industries sells Mac 10 parts. These are from FTF, and I think I bought 8 of them, and they work really good so far. These are based on the old RPB tooling, so they're brand new mags based on RPB tooling. A real Mac 10 mag for 9mm is based on a Sterling mag, and they cost $150 each. These are a lot cheaper than that. I think these are like $25-$30 in 2020, and it fits in there good. Just like that, it clicks in. So I'm gonna go ahead and take this upper off, and we're gonna talk about these mags real quick. Let's see if I can get this on camera. I know this is gonna be a longer video, but I don't think anybody really goes into depth much about. And each one of these uppers came with a standard pin, or actually a captured detent pin, as opposed to this two-piece pin here that was in the factory gun. So that pin is better. Let's see. Okay, so here's the upper. It is not any different than the 45. Just the barrel and the bolt are different. So here is the inside of this gun. And here's the magwell adapter shoved down in the top there. And if you look at the bottom, you can see that it's thinner. So what was happening with these mags is they would bounce. They would bounce like this, up and down. So when the bolt hit the feed lips, it would actually bounce down, and it wouldn't be able to strip around off the top. And I would push it up, and it would fire. So when you held it up, it would hold it in the right position, but you'd have to hold the mag to get it to shoot. And what I ended up doing is I ended up, since it came with this mag catch, since I bought the extra mag catch for the 45, I took the mag catch that was in it and I filed it to fit these mags. So I actually machined it down, I took a file and I filed it down so that it would hold these things up in the right spot. And it runs almost 100%. It runs very reliably with 115 grain. Now, it will not run with 147 grain. So this little feed ramp here is built into the mag adapter, and the 147 grain will not make the turn up. They're too fat, they stop, right? So it only works with 115 grain. It runs 100%, like I have no problem running it. You know, you just have to deal with that bolt bounce. When the bolt runs backwards, it pops down on the mag and pushes that mag down. So filing that mag catch down made it fit perfectly. It is important that if you're shopping for the Mac 10 mags, that they have this stop here on them and they have the catch. It's the distance between the stops on the side and the catch on the back that lets it work. So being able to fit my own magazine mount is what allowed me to get this thing to run good. And you'll notice here, the light marks here are the bolt rubbing on the top of this mag. So I assume, given enough rounds, these mags will stop working. It's just the nature of how violent this gun is. And it's rubbing away that finish on these. I bought 8 mags and 7 of them run pretty good. So I might buy 8 more and be done with it. How many mags do you need? How many mags can you carry? You know, Really, if you're going to go out and shoot this thing, you really need to load them all up beforehand because it's hard to get ammo right now. But that's my lessons learned. I did have to fit a mag catch to get this thing to work good. It did not have a magazine when I bought it, and that was probably a big turnoff because it's hard to get mags. But these RPB mags work pretty good from FTF Industries. So other than that, it's been fine. I don't think I'll be able to run 147 grain unless I get a second mag adapter and take this feed ramp off. It might be able to actually make the turn up, but it really needs to bump up, bump the round up as opposed to the 45 to get it to be able to fit in there correctly. So I don't know, who knows? You know, subsonic, running subsonic and silence is one of the big selling points for the MAC-10, but if it runs fine on 115 grain, that's what I'm gonna buy anyway. It's really hard to get 147 grain in bulk to begin with. The other thing with this is that this mag here is actually a dual feed mag. It's not a single feed. The 45s are a dual stack into single feed, and it is extremely hard to load these. And you can get those grease gun loaders to fit them. But this is actually a dual feed. It's very easy to load them. They'll take 32 rounds. I usually load them to 20 or 25. I mean, if you have a box of 50, two sticks of 25 is perfect for a machine gun, you know, and for most people that'll work fine. So I usually load them to 25. After about 25 rounds, that round starts to stick weird. Like it starts to get pushed out from those feed lips. And I think, you know, if I put hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of rounds through these, eventually it won't be able to hold them. If you keep it to like 20 rounds, it doesn't do the weird mag angle on the bullet. But anyway, if you look at this bolt here, it is designed to run with the dual feed lip. See, this is the bottom of the bolt that strips around out. If you look, that mag fits right in here like this, right here where this edge is, just like this here. It goes right in there and it fits that fine. I don't think that Lage makes a single stack bolt. If you go on FTF Industries, they make single stack bolts. I would not recommend running a single stack. As long as you can still get these mags, I would get these FTF mags. They work really good. And I was able to get them to get every one of the mags I have. They work fine. So anyway, these are some of the lessons learned that I've had. I'm glad that it's running a 9mm. I am glad it is not a 45 only gun. I am glad that I can run 45 in it if I want to, because you never know. I have actually learned that Brown Bear and Wolf and Tula all run great, so thank God that the cheap ammo works good. You'll notice in some of my videos, the Brown Bear ammo actually ran faster than some of the Winchester, so the ammo actually has a big effect on the rate of fire. I would say this is probably around 8 to 850. I have run it almost exclusively suppressed. So, yeah. Yeah, see. So what was happening, and now this is open, there is no ammo in this. So if you look in there, you can see the ejector. The magazine would actually push up too far, and you wouldn't have this gap in the ejector here. The magazine would actually bump into the ejector with the factory mag catch. And when it would hit the ejector, the bolt would push the mag back down and push it out of the gun, so it was unreliable. But now that I've stabilized that distance there between this ejector and this mag catch, it does feed right up in there correctly to the feed ramp for the 9mm. Now, I don't know what the factory 9mm look like, because I don't think a factory 9mm would have that feed ramp built onto it. See, if you look at that feed ramp inside of there, it feeds right up into there, and that's why you can't run 147 grains. 147 grains won't make the turn. but I assume that the grip on the 9mm is shorter and places that mag higher up, because if you notice, there's a big gap that it has to jump to the barrel. And it's also a dual feed. So you have to account for bullets coming in two directions, as opposed to the 45, which is only a single feed, if that makes sense. So those are some of my lessons learned with the MAC-10. I love this thing. Glad I got it. I'm glad I got it now in my life when I'm young enough to be able to put it on my credit card and let the interest build on it for a couple years, because I haven't paid it off. I'm glad that I can enjoy it.
It is better, it is easier to enjoy than a Barrett, because nobody would let me shoot my Barrett, so that's why I sold it. That red dot was almost perfectly zeroed. So I didn't have to adjust at all. I put it on there, and it's dead nuts on at 35 yards. I think these Lage uppers are the reason these things went up in price. Here, we can take this apart. I'll show you the difference between a factory upper and a Lage upper, because there literally is no difference between the barrel and the bolt between the two uppers. The Lage 45 upper came with a 5/8 by, I don't know, whatever the factory 5/8 is, whatever the 308 threading is, 5/8 by 24. And I put this 5/8 by 24 to 5/7/8 45 adapter so I can run a 45 can on it. I actually red Loctite that in. There's no reason to take that off. So this is just a basic breakdown here. The thing comes out, then you have a 45 bolt, and then you have your empty aluminum Lage upper. Now the factory one, pretty standard. There's a lot of videos about how this comes apart. I promise I've taken this apart before. And if you'll notice, size difference is the big deal. Actually, you know what's funny? It doesn't really weigh that much different. I wonder if, I think I got rid of my scales, but there is more room for weight, because this amount of weight here is actually enough to slow it down. This actually is, oh yeah, this actually looks like one of those CNC bolts, so it might be a little bit heavier than a factory cast bolt, which is also on FTF Industries. If you notice, a factory bolt has a little scallop here. This feels CNC to me. If you'll notice, it looks like it's a single stack mag too. This is skinnier than the bottom of the other bolt, which is set up for a dual stack. Actually, it looks more like this 45 single stack. I'm looking at this track here. This is skinnier. But this actually CNC bolt does, it might be a little bit heavier than the factory cast MAC 10 bolt. So that's why it might not be as fast in my original video. But the fact that this bolt is, oh yeah, it does feel actually significantly heavier. That weight is what slows it down to under 900. I think it does run a little bit faster than the advertised 750. I think it's closer to 800, but it's perfect. It runs good. I'm very happy with it. And ironically, the 45 might have a different weight than the 9mm, which this is a 9mm bolt anyway. So there you go. See, it's not very dirty. I haven't really shot the 45 much. I would love to shoot it more. The nice thing about 45 is it's all subsonic and it's been really reliable. So subsonic's where it's at, man, because it's still pretty loud with that crack on 9mm. But it allows me to run sling mount on this. I had an aim point on this, but I took it off to mount it on my RPD. So yeah. So there you go.